Rat Rock Nation, it's Carl Kraft from the Morning Rat Race with Andy from Blackville Brides. Welcome to the Jersey Shore, live from Hollywood, Andy.
I'm very happy to be here. Yeah, it's the miracle of technology, Zoom. We're everywhere now.
Who knew? Who knew that Zoom would be so cool? You guys got so much going on with Blackville Brides. The Scarlet Cross sounds great on the air. It sounds like it's been on the air for a. It sounds like it's been on the air for a long time. So we got to talk about the music. We also have to talk about what's going on with Amazon and Paradise City, because there's a lot of really exciting stuff going on for you and Black Veil Brides right now, which is amazing considering what the hell we're sitting in right now.
Sure.
How do you get this momentum during a pandemic, Andy?
I mean, I think in a lot of ways, I've been very fortunate that a lot of things that were in the kind of early stages of being worked on had come together within the last couple months. So, you know, many things, like we had started working on this record about 2 months prior to the pandemic starting. And so we at least had a jumping off point that once we were able to kind of get into a room and there was safety and all that stuff, we kind of understood what was happening, we could keep working on the album. So we were able to do that. Similarly, the show had already been shot and was in the process of being edited and pitched right when the pandemic started. So with Paradise City, that was already kind of done. So it's one of those things where I'm benefiting from the fact that a lot of things that were worked on last year or the year prior are kind of all coming out at once, whether it's my book or all these other things. So we just feel really lucky that in a time where, you know, don't get me wrong, it was a very bizarre situation the first couple months when you're kind of floating and going, we're a touring rock band, what do we do? So to be in this position and be able to have a bunch of stuff that's happening and to be able to connect with fans on levels like doing these acoustic shows and everything, it's a great position to be in.
We're really looking forward to the acoustic set, and that is coming up in just a few minutes after we get to meet and chat a little bit. I feel like you've always been a multimedia kind of performer, right? What chops came first, acting, singing? Both, what did you say? Oh, I want to do that.
I think it's always been a little bit of everything. I feel like I've kind of talked about, I was an only child, so I was pretty insufferable as a kid. Like I just wanted everybody to have to watch me do things. And, you know, my parents kind of allowed me to dress up in costumes and perform. And it was, for me as a kid, I always say like, whether it was heavy metal and hard rock or wrestling or comic books or musicals or all these things, like, they all kind of seemed like one experience to me. And so, you know, it isn't until later in life, because I grew up kind of before the invention of the connectivity of everybody. So like these subsections of entertainment kind of all were just filtered through like what I liked. So when I was a kid, I wanted to be the world's first like professional hockey playing, stand-up comedian, rock star, multi-hyphenate. Like that was kind of the plan, right? And so as I've gotten older, it's just been fun to be able to dip my toe into these different places. So, you know, I host a pregame radio show for the Cincinnati Bengals football team, and I'm writing a book, and I'm the voice of Batman on a cartoon series, and I get to be in a rock band. Like in so many ways, the way that the world trended and the way that your ability to make these different types of things and be connected in this way, like it really worked to benefit the kind of thoughts of grandeur I had as a kid.
Paradise City seems to take a lot of that and go way over the top. I mean, this is, you know, you've got some major hitters. Sure. And Andrea, we know her from Sopranos. Yeah. We love her here in New Jersey for that alone. And the rest of the cast is very strong.
Yeah.
Do you feel like this is, I mean, I feel like it, is this a, it seems like a major, major step. This, you know, the story is just ripped straight out of the rock and roll folklore. Yeah. And there's so many good pieces that are involved in it.
Yeah. I mean, I think the other thing that's like really, when you look at it from the perspective of being people that love rock and roll music, it is so, I'm just so pleased to be a part of something that is flying that flag, so to speak, in a time where you know, the world doesn't, the top 40 charts don't see the rock world that we know exists, that we know is vibrant, that we know has a heartbeat that is still very much alive. It's nice to be able to take something with recognizable mainstream faces and put it in this context of the rock world and bring these rock bands and this tremendous soundtrack and all the things that we as rock fans love, to be able to put that in front of people who otherwise aren't ingratiated to it, I think is really important. And it's cool because the more of that kind of stuff, the more people find rock and roll music and can kind of see the history and how all these things that are currently popular or in the kind of mainstream consciousness borrow heavily from stuff that we've loved all along, whether it's classic rock bands or whatever it is. So yeah, I mean, it's, for me, it's a huge step because being a rock musician and being able to be in a television series with all these incredible actors and just to be a part of this cast is, first of all, it was incredibly like lucky experience that I got to know Ash and that he wanted me to be a part of this. Ash Albison, the writer director. But also it's just, you know, I wanted to show up to work and do my best and to try to feel like I fit within the context of all these people.
It's interesting that you would put it in supporting the rock community. I like that. And because right now it really feels like the rock community, you know, we can't get together. And our meeting place is out in front of you as you perform, singing and clapping, sometimes crying along.
Yeah.
This is an opportunity for people to come together in a spot that to support and be part of the rock community that we wouldn't normally have. That's really kind of interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I think, as you said, like the reality of not having rock shows, it's nice to have anything. And by the way, this is not a singular situation. All of these bands that have gotten together through the course of this last year to put together online shows and to try to keep that alive, I think the rock community has done a great job of maintaining some elements of what we have. But you're right, at the end of the day, loud live rock and roll is what this is all about, you know.
What do you miss the most about that performance?
You know, it's interesting. Like I started when I was so young. I started touring, you know, full time by the time I was 18 years old. So I kind of just got to the point where, admittedly, it was such second nature and I was spending 9-10 months of the year on the road all the time that all of the connectivity and the excitement and the buzz of this kind of like what's called like electric church, right? Like this feeling of everybody's in a room and you're singing along. I don't want to say I took it for granted, but I didn't realize how much it shapes me as a person. So I think just the act of being in a room with somebody and having the song that you're singing, whether it's 5 people or 5 million people, whatever it is, to have that be reflected in somebody else and them sing along with you. Like it is a singularly interesting phenomenon that I think we're now seeing when it's not in the world, it's severely lacking. And there's almost no other medium that gets that experience. You can watch a movie from home and it's maybe not the same as watching a movie on screen, but watching a concert from home, while it can be fun and I hope people enjoy it, it is not the same experience because the people at the show are what makes up the show, not the band on stage necessarily.
Yeah, yeah, no, it's definitely, there's definitely community camaraderie. Sometimes, I mean, shit, comes down to fights too, you know? It's like there's angst, there's positive, there's love, it's all, you know, it's all out there in the crowd in between us and you on stage.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think we've all been to shows that were small shows that had a great crowd that felt just like big shows and big shows with a bad crowd. You know, and by bad crowd, I mean, the band's not vibing with the audience isn't vibing with the band. Yeah. That can make for, even if it's a huge crowd, that can make for a less enjoyable concert experience.
For everyone involved.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, when I was performing as a stand-up, if I didn't get with the audience, I mean, I felt awful afterwards.
Sure, yeah.
You know, it was... Yeah. Not a fun experience at all. Let me ask you a little bit about The Phantom Tomorrow and Scarlet Cross and what this represents for the band in terms of sound and look. What are you hoping to get out of it and where do you hope it takes you?
Well, you know, I think we're in a position as a band where, I mean, you kind of get to this point where you discover who you are as a band over the course of, I think it takes several records for any band to really find their sound. And I think we've found that. And I think the most important thing is that it's kind of a double-edged sword because you can find your sound and then go, well, all right, that's what we're going to do forever and just kind of rest on your laurels. Or you can feel like you're confident in what you're doing and then try to expand outside of that. And I think that as more of this record is heard and as more singles come out and as this progresses, I think people will see, at least that's the hope, that we have tried our best to expand what we do, but also remain true to the sound that hopefully they've enjoyed with the band for a number of years. So for us, this is just, it is a record that was made during one of the weirdest times in human history. It's a record that was made with extreme attention to detail and dedication because of the fact that we were granted this time to do so. We could be in the studio for a year and just pay attention to this album. And I think it shows. I think when people hear the record, even whether they like it or not, I think you can see that we cared a great deal about what this is. And obviously the hope is that people enjoy it, but we didn't sit down and say, let's make a pandering record to try to get people to like this. We sat down and said, we know who we are as a band. Let's make the best record we can. And hopefully that is reflected in the people who hear it.
Do you think that the closeness that COVID brought you guys, did you get closer because of it? Were you a tighter knit? Not that you necessarily could be as a band traveling so much together, but I feel like for our own staff here at the radio station, we're tighter knit as a result of all this. Do you feel that way?
Sure. I mean, I've always said it's a very unique thing being in a band. The setup to be in a band is, oh, you like this band? I like this band too. Let's go play their songs and maybe we can learn to write songs. Whatever it is, you know, we both like Black Sabbath. Let's go cover a song. And that's like the basis for the start of a band. And then if it works out and you write songs and you guys like each other, then you're going to spend the next entirety of your adult life sitting next to that person, regardless of whether you know anything about them or not. You find out all this stuff about people. It is the most bizarre marriage you can have. So for years, the band was, there's nothing to share with you. Like if I'm sitting on a plane next to you and something weird happens, I can't tell you that story. We spend our whole life together. You know what I mean? Like hey, I wouldn't believe what I did yesterday. Yes, I will, because I've been there with you every day. Right. So what we got to was a point of kind of this, I don't want to say apathy, but we just experienced all of our life together. And then we went through kind of the ebbs and flows of the band situation. And last year, prior to all this, we retooled everything and we kind of really reconnected. And so going into all this, we were at a better place. So I think what this has given us is an opportunity to learn more about each other as people, to spend time talking about things other than just the bands, to go over when it's, you know, safe to do so, go over to each other's homes and see each other and that kind of thing. Like, it is a different dynamic now than it was 5 or 6 years ago. And I think you're right that a situation like this, it just lends itself to that sort of thing.
What are we about to hear? Tell us about your approach to this acoustic set we're about to enjoy. And thank you so much for bringing Black Veil Brides to the Jersey Shore in this way.
Yeah, I mean, I think, first of all, it's just exciting to get to do this. The biggest thing that was exciting about this was the opportunity to get together in a rehearsal room and put together a set list and do song options and try songs that work and do songs that don't work and all that stuff. Like the sense of, we're a rock and roll band doing rock and roll band things. So we are extremely appreciative for the opportunity. And first of all, thank you for playing our song because it's given us a chance to do things like this that we've never done before. This is our first time doing these acoustic sets in the entirety of our career. So we're trying to play songs that will run the gambit of our whole career. And we've really liked that each time we've done one of these shows, it's a surprise for our fans. So I won't give away the set list just yet, but you will hear Scarlet Cross. I can promise you that.
Okay, good, good. Thanks for working it out, because it's not easy to take things and drag them into a different acoustic setting than you may have originally imagined. And that takes some artistic talent. So we appreciate that effort.
Well, hopefully we succeeded.
Well, we'll see. No, listen, they're about to decide, man. So
yeah, there you go. There you go.
Gentlemen, it's Black Veil Brides. And Andy, thanks for your time. Best of luck. And we hope this next time is an actual handshake in person.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Hey, WRAT in Jersey. We're Black Veil Brides, and we're going to play some songs for you. This first one's called Scarlet Cross.
My pain, find holy embrace. Stay with me and I'm afraid of my soul. Blackened and left in control. Hold on to me and you can't deny the end is coming.
We have never played before in any capacity in any show. It's our first time ever playing this, so hopefully you enjoy it. This is off our second record. This one's called Ritual.
Of escape and bloodshot eyes. You're barely dreaming, no longer sleeping. Now what you do to feel alive? Rise up and celebrate your life. We're not alone in our ritual. Sing for what you feel inside. Songs of the old days drown away.
Yeah. Hey, we did it. Thank you very much, Jersey. That was our first time doing that, so hopefully you enjoyed it. We're going to play one right now off of our fourth record. I almost said second record. This is the Bob Rock record. This is called Goodbye Agony.
Place my cards upon the table, in blood I draw the line. I've given all my pride. I'm living a life of misery, always there just underneath, haunting me. I'm quietly alone. You were all I had begun. I'm letting go of what I once believed. So goodbye, agony. I watch the stars and setting suns as the years are passing by. I never knew that hope was fatal until I looked it in the eye. And now I'm not sure I am able to reach the other side, casting out the lights. I'm living a life of misery, always there just underneath, haunting me. I'm quietly alone. Dead and gone, and what's done is done. You were all I had become. I'm letting go of what I once believed. So goodbye, agony. I'm not alone in forgiving the faithful and the blind. Innocence is forsaken. I leave. And then I see that even angels never die.
Not just where the devil is. We went to the devil's house and saw Aerosmith. Never there. No, we saw Aerosmith at that arena.
Yeah.
It was a good show.
I wasn't there.
Oh, you went. Yeah. Jinx wasn't there. We didn't invite him. You weren't there either?
No, I didn't make it.
So just CeCe and I.
Yeah, it was a great time.
CeCe and I went to the devil's house. We saw Aerosmith. Thank you so much, New Jersey. This has been a lot of fun. This one is our last one. It's called In the End. It goes like this.
In the end, as you fade into the night, who will tell the story of your life? In the end, as my soul's laid to rest, what is left of my body? Or am I just a shell? And I have fought, and with flesh and blood I commanded an army. Through it all I have given my heart for a moment of glory. In the end, as you fade into the night,
Jersey. See you next time.